Hello and welcome back. I'm Gail Carmona and I'm here to talk with you today about the EIPA and your assessment with the EIPA. So specifically today, we'll talk about the use of fingerspelling. So how do we know what to fingerspell when we go into our assessment with the EIPA? Well, they do post on their website a rating form. So I'm going to use that as a reference, and I'm going to talk to you about specifically the categories they are looking at when it comes to fingerspelling. And by the way, I will put a link for the EIPA's website down below in the comments for you to look at later if you'd like to. So on their rating form, they talk about four specific areas that are dealing with vocabulary. One is key vocabulary being represented, production of fingerspelling, spelled correctly, and appropriate use of fingerspelling. So we're going to talk about those things. Before we do, though, I want to just talk about one other thing they mention on the website. It says very specifically, fingerspelling is a very important skill for students to learn, who learn through an interpreter, as well as an important tool in developing English literacy. Students who develop good fingerspelling skills have bigger reading vocabularies. Educational interpreters should use fingerspelling in their everyday interpretation, even for words where there are signs. So we're going to talk about that in our use of fingerspelling. But so here's the point. This is about literacy, right? So that's a thought we want to have in mind when we're making decisions during the assessment as to when to fingerspell it. Now, what happens if we come across something that the teacher is saying during the assessment that we don't know the sign for? Well, it is appropriate to fingerspell. If you find that you're fingerspelling constantly through the exam, then perhaps you're at a stage where you don't really have quite enough signing vocabulary to really work in the field of interpreting. However, if you come across words here and there that you don't know the sign for, it's good to have a strategy before we go into the exam. Think to yourself, what will happen if they use a word that I don't know the sign for? Well, fingerspelling is one strategy. Another strategy, of course, is to explain the word, to use other signs. But fingerspelling, because of literacy, is a very, very important thing to do. Sandwiching, maybe you've heard that term. Sandwiching is a good idea if you can make time for it, depending on the pace of the speaker, right? The teacher, if we can. Sandwiching is what? Sandwiching is fingerspelling the word, giving the sign, fingerspelling the word, all for the sake of literacy, to help the student expand their vocabulary, to be able to read what's perhaps on one of their tests or exams. So sandwiching is good. If we can't do it, suppose the pace is just too quick, and if we were to do the sandwiching, we would miss a chunk of primary information right after. Well, we don't want to do that. So in that case, we would want to fingerspell and then give the sign, or conversely, give the sign and then fingerspell. Either way is fine. But we want to at very least try to provide the fingerspelled word and the sign. When? Well, that's when we're going to go and we're going to talk a little bit more about the appropriate use of fingerspelling and key vocabulary. One other thought before we get into that, sometimes interpreters will think or say to me, well, can't I invent a sign? Like, suppose the teacher's using this word over and over and over again, and can I just invent a sign? Like, fingerspell it once, give an invented sign, and then use the invented sign. Why is that not a great idea? Well, normally when you're working in a school setting with a student, if you invent a sign and a sub comes along, the student may be very lost because that sub doesn't know your invented sign. Or, for example, you work with a student for the full school year and then they go into their next grade and they're lost again because they have been given invented signs that the next interpreter or other students are not going to be using. or they may have the same interpreter for many years and being used quite a few invented signs, and then they go out in the deaf community and others are not using these signs. These are invented signs. So we don't want to go down that path. So what we would do is we would continue to fingerspell. And really that benefits the child because that helps with their literacy. Right now, I would like very much to learn Spanish. I have been trying. And if I'm exposed one time to a new Spanish word, I promise you, I won't retain it. Two times, three times, four times, maybe. But generally speaking, I need to be exposed to that new vocabulary in Spanish quite a number of times before I retain it and I can use it. And this is true of the students that we're working with as well. When it comes to literacy, they need to see it again and again and again. So as those words came up on the assessment, we want to fingerspell them again and again and again. Okay, so now let's talk about specifically those four categories that they are looking at and they are rating, okay? So what are they? Well, key vocabulary is one. What's key vocabulary? Well, the great thing about this assessment is they give you a list of the key vocabulary. So when you go in, that's what you're going to want to fingerspell. You're going to want to fingerspell and give the sign for it. And if you can sandwich it, even better still. Okay, so that's the number one thing. So what is key vocabulary? If you're in the exam, or in real life, it is things that are going to appear on your test, right? It's going to be things that, you know, are involved with grammar. These are going to be the things, the key words that these students will need to retain from the lesson, right? And also too, one of the other categories, it was key vocabulary, production of fingerspelling. Well, that goes kind of without saying, right? We want to produce our words correctly, our letters rather. We don't want to have our A out here, we want to have it here. So things of that nature, our S wants to be clear, not like this, you know. So production should be very clear. It should be fluent or didactic. What is didactic? Well, for example, my last name is Carmona. I do not want to think when I'm fingerspelling C-A-R-M-O-N-A, no, because that's difficult to look at. It's kind of bouncy, right? So what I would want to do is do it in a didactic way or more in a syllable style. Carmona, right? Carmona. And so being exposed to that repeatedly, they would learn my last name. And you may retain it now too. Okay, so that's our production of fingerspelling, being our clarity, fluency, and rate. Also the speed in which. Now that's an interesting thing, right? Because would an elementary school student be able to grasp fingerspelling at the same speed as a high school student? Not really, right? So we would want to adjust for the age of the child that we're interpreting for. That goes without saying in our work, right? But when we go into the assessment, we want to think the same thing. What is the age group that I'm interpreting for here? And make sure that our fingerspelling speed matches that group. Now, does that mean every single time we have to use a slower pace because, you know, for the student? Well, I would say, generally speaking, when we fingerspell, most of us, the first time we're exposed to it, it does need to be slower. The second time, maybe still very thoughtful, slower, still didactic, but slowly. And then afterwards, it might speed up. It might speed up because the student has now seen it two times, three times. So we continue to fingerspell as it's used in the lesson, but we could speed up a little more, especially with a high school student, right? That we can start to speed up and make it a little bit quicker. So that is production of fingerspell. And now let's talk about spelled correctly. We need to spell it correctly. And we know what that means, right? So the appropriate use of fingerspelling, there is also other words that the student may not be exposed to. For example, the word tool, right? Hammer, saw, wrench. We could be giving all these signs and mean tools, but we want to expose the child to the word tool. The same is true of a word like meadow, grassy area, grassy area, grassy area. And you could have a high school student graduate and never have been exposed to meadow. So as an interpreter, we want to make the important literacy choices and choose to fingerspell and expose the student to the sign. So I believe that is most of it. So you're affecting your score, your overall score in four areas by how you choose to fingerspell. So I'm really hoping that this little explanation today will help you score very high in those four categories.